All right, so we're going to pick up today with some basic embedded system data. So this picture here shows a series of vessels. These are the lymphatic vessels, and they come in a variety of different sizes, and they help to move a material called lymph throughout the individual or throughout the organism. So the lymphatic system really is a system of vessels. In addition to the vessels, there are also some additional organs. The spleen and the thymus are two of the most prominent that aid in the lymphatic process. So you're going to have additional organs, the spleen, the spleen and thymus up through the tonsils, the bone marrow, is also a tissue that has some lymphatic responsibility. But primarily when we talk about the lymphatic system, we typically look at that system of vessels. And these vessels are classified as one-way vessels. And so that means that the lymph flows just in a single direction. It doesn't circulate. It flows from the tissue through a bunch of lymphatic organs called lymph nodes, and it cleanses the lymph, cleans up the lymph, and eventually it's deposited back into the bloodstream. And it's located, the location of the deposit is right here below the clavicles. You have subclavian veins that accept the lymph after it's passed through the entirety of the lymph system through these one-way vessels. Now, these one-way vessels, if we start in a tissue bed, let's take, for sake of argument, the gastroc muscle. So you're going to find lymph vessels that are called lymph capillaries. They're very, very small. And then as we move back towards the heart, as we get closer and closer to the heart and closer to those subclavian veins, the size of these vessels increases. Size of the vessel is going to increase. We're going to get a larger and larger diameter vessel as we move back towards the heart. So what I'd like to do is take each of these vessels and look at the vessels, the different size vessels, a little bit more detail, give you an idea where they're located and what their function is going to be. And we're going to start with the very small, which are called lymphatic capillaries. And they're similar, but not identical, but similar to the blood capillaries that we've already discussed with circulation. So in green are our lymphatic vessels, our lymphatic capillaries. They intermix through the capillary bed. So this is our capillary bed. You have a small little kind of local circulation that services a handful of cells. And then mixed in there, you have these lymphatic capillaries. And notice that they are blind on one end. They don't connect to anything. So we call them blind-ended vessels. And they run through our capillaries. Now, these blind-ended capillaries, if we were to look at the structure blown up, they're an individual layer of cells, and in between each of the cells, they're relatively wide open. So this is within a capillary bed, so we have other tissue in there, we have our capillaries, all that kind of stuff. The larger space between individual cells allows things like bacteria to enter into the lymphatic capillary. We don't really see that in our blood, which is a good thing, because we don't want bacteria in our blood. So the blind-ended capillaries, they're able to pick up bacteria and large substances. Thank you. bacteria and larger substances. In the interior of these capillaries is a solution, or a solution is constantly being produced along with the bacteria and larger molecules. You're also picking up excess tissue, so an excess water, watery solution. And we call that lymph. Now, lymph, it contains water. It also can contain white blood cells, protein, and in some cases, depending on where the lymphatic vessel is located, it can also contain some pretty high concentrations of fats or lipids. In particular, the lymphatics are associated with the digestive system. It's the main way to, lipids are very large molecules. They can have many, many, many carbons all chained together. So they're big molecules, so they'll get picked up by the wind, not by the circulation. So because of the components that are present, the lymph becomes milky in its appearance. It's kind of a milky white substance in appearance. Again, because there's a large concentration of white blood cells, proteins, fats, and lipids. And then during illness, we're also going to find a high concentration of invaders. So in other words, the consistency of the lymph changes depending on the status of the organism. If you just ate a full fatty meal, maybe you made it over the five guys that got murdered, and just ingested a large amount of fat, you're going to increase the fat content of the lymph. If you get sick and you have a bacterial infection, you'll increase the bacterial content. So the lymph is a pretty dynamic variable solution that constantly changes in response to the organism and what's going on in the organism. Now, as we move away from the capillary beds, the lymphatic capillaries increase in size, and we dump that lymphatic solution from the capillaries into lymphatic vessels. And the lymphatic vessels, again, they are going to be larger vessels. You can see we still have the ability to move things in through gaps between the individual cells, but then we're also going to begin to see these flaps on the inner lumen, or the inner area of the lymphatic capillary, and these are one-way valves, and they'll allow blood on the lymph to move towards the heart, but don't allow it to move back away. So this is a mechanism for us to be able to move lymph in the right direction, fighting against the effects of gravity, moving in front of our toes all the way back up to the subclavian vein. Again, they're formed by merged capillaries. This is actually a very similar appearance to veins. We're also going to find those one-way valves in veins. They will be made up of three different layers of tissue. This figure is really only showing one of those layers, the very inner layer. But we have actually three layers of tissue. We have an additional layer of connective tissue, and then there's also a layer of smooth muscle. That very inner layer of cells is where we'll find the one-way valves. And again, those are to control flow. Now, we have to move the lymph from down in our lower extremities, hands back up towards the heart. So that's a pretty good distance, and if you're vertical, you have to still continue to do this. You can't lie down every time you bring the limb to eliminate the effects of gravity. there are two mechanisms in addition to the one-way valves, two additional mechanisms. The valves really just hold the limb from going back down. There are two mechanisms that are going to move the limb in the right direction. The first is called the skeletal muscle pump. You remember back when we discussed skeletal muscle that we had this thing called muscle tone, and your muscles are basically always sort of under this continuous form of contraction to keep those sarcomeres at optimal length. So as that skeletal muscle goes through those contractions, there are going to be lymphatics that are laid right alongside the muscle. So here's my muscle. This is the muscle here. And then this is the lymph. And as that muscle squeezes, and there'd be another muscle on the other side, as that muscle squeezes and maintains tone, it pushes on those vessels. And so you have kind of an overall impetus to move in that direction. This would be back towards the heart. This is the feet down here, or wherever we're on, and it's the hands. But the muscles continually contract, and they push on the lymphatic vessels to move blood in that direction. And then you have all of these one-way valves that, as the blood flows through, I actually drew them the wrong way, in fact. And then in the other direction. As the blood flows through, it then will flow back just a little bit and be closed on the valves up. So it's kind of like three steps or no steps. So that's one of the mechanisms that we use to induce flow of lymph back towards the heart from our lower extremities and other locations in the body. The second mechanism is the respiratory system changes. Every time we breathe, what happens to the thoracic cavity? Remember? Thoracic cavity increases its volume, which decreases pressure. The heart is located in that thoracic cavity. The subclavian veins are located in that thoracic cavity. So every time you breathe, you actually create a situation where you significantly drop the pressure around the end of the tube. And so as we go through the muscle pump and use our one-way valves, you're inducing a situation that is favorable for the lymphatic solution to move back towards the subclavian veins. From the lymphatic vessels, we move into another large lymphatic part of the lymphatic system called the lymphatic ducts. Lymphatic duct actually runs right up the center of the individual. One structure to point out is this thing called the cisterna of Kiley. And this particular organ is actually a place where we can reserve or store lymph. And typically it's the lymph that comes from the digestive system. So this would be contains a high fat concentration. And then that duct, this one is called the thoracic duct, moves up and connects in here to that subclavian vein. So the duct is going to be the largest tube, and it's a relatively sizable tube. You'll be able to stick your finger in. It's a collection of all of the lymphatic vessels from specific locations that all come up and eventually feed into the lymphatic ducts. So these are formed by merging our vessels. And the one I'm showing here is called the thoracic duct. There's actually two major ducts that we find. The first one is the right lymphatic duct. And then the second one, as shown here, is the thoracic duct. And these two major ducts, they actually drain really the left and the right side of the body's lymphatic circulation, or the right and the left side of the body. And again, we terminate both of these. terminate both of these ducts at large veins near the shoulders. Just below the clavicle. And as they empty into these veins, they're obviously mixing back into the bloodstream. Now, I told you at the very beginning that we're picking up bacteria and other microorganisms. Do I want to put those bacteria and microorganisms in my house? Probably not a good idea, because then I'm just putting them everywhere. I'm just going to circulate them to every reach of the body. So those bacteria and other chemicals and toxins, they actually have to be removed from the lymph. And as you move along the lymph system, there are groups of accessory organs called lymph nodes located systematically at periodic locations along the lymph from capillary back up to subclavian vein. And the lymph is going to pass through multiple lymph nodes on its trip back in towards the general circulation, back to where it empties into that vein. And the lymph node, you can see, is here in cross-section with lymph coming in and then ability for lymph to leave. When the lymph is inside of this main part of the lymph node, it's going to be exposed to high concentrations of white blood cells. Those white blood cells are going to be used to break down bacteria to get rid of toxins and foreign invaders. So really, the lymph nodes are going to be lymph cleansers. Again, we find the lymph nodes spaced along the vessels. And a given volume of lymph is going to travel through multiple lymph nodes, and each lymph node is going to cleanse the lymph a little bit more. And the reason that the lymph nodes can cleanse the lymph so effectively is because the lymph nodes house white blood cells. And in particular, two types of white blood cells are going to be found in pretty high concentration. Macrophages and lymphocytes. And these macrophages and lymphocytes are both phagocytic cells. That means they like to eat things, they like to break down molecules and other foreign invaders. So their presence helps to identify microorganisms and then allows them to be destroyed. So as you pass through lymph nodes, those bacteria are going to be spotted, they're going to be identified and destroyed. The spleen is another accessory organ. Here you can see the spleen in cross-section. It's got a pretty stout blood flow through the spleen. Blood flows into the spleen from an artery right off our circulation. So blood flows in from an artery. And once that blood is inside of the spleen, it's going to be exposed to two different types of tissue. And I don't know if you can see it here in this picture, but there are small little white dots, and then there's primarily this red tissue. This is a cross-sectional tissue sample and you can see the two different types of tissue. So there's these little white kind of spots, and then the rest of it is this reddish tissue. The white spots are called white pulp, and the red stuff is called red pulp. So we have these two types of tissue present. Those two types of tissue that are present are going to have different abilities to interact with the blood itself and hopefully to clean that blood up. Now, the red pulp, it contains a large concentration or a large number of those macrophages. These were those cells. We also call them in the lymph nodes. Literally, the name macrophage means big eater, and they like to eat bacteria. They like to consume bacteria and destroy bacteria. So if you end up with bacteria in the bloodstream, it's going to eventually circulate to the spleen, be exposed to the red pulp, and that red pulp will clean up that blood. So the lymph nodes help to remove microorganisms from the lymph. The spleen does the same thing to the blood. But in addition to that microorganism removal ability, we also remove old blood cells. The red blood cell in particular has about a 120-day lifespan. After those 120 days are up, we're going to actually remove a lot of those red blood cells here in the spleen, also in the liver. Now, that blood that's been cleansed of microorganisms and removed some of those old red blood cells, some of it circulates back into the general circulation as cleansed blood. Some of that blood is actually going to be stored. So that cleansed blood is put into a reservoir within the spleen, and it's held in the spleen. And if you ever have an injury where you have a substantial loss of blood, this blood can be called out of storage to replace the blood that's been lost, and it's a protective mechanism. So that's the red pulp. These little specks of white here are called white pulp. And the white pulp has a whitish appearance because of the cells that are present. Lymphocytes have a very white appearance, and there's a high concentration of lymphocytes found here in the white pulp. Now, when the blood gets exposed to the white pulp, it's being exposed to these lymphocytes. And those lymphocytes really attack foreign particles, material that's not supposed to be in the blood, much the same as we saw with the lymphatic, with the lymph nodes, I should say. So we have foreign particle destruction. Now, during an active infection, maybe you have a bacterial infection, you're actually going to see the spleen will swell. And that's just like a factory that's going to full capacity. You increase the amount of that factory floor that you're utilizing, you increase the number of workers that are in that factory. So during infection, this is the work, the work required of the spleen. And so the spleen goes to full capacity and swells. Now, during an infection, when you have a spleen that swells, you've probably heard people before, you know, I was out snowboarding or I was out skiing or whatever they were doing, and they ruptured their spleen. Most likely it was during an infection when the spleen is a little bit more swelled, comes a little bit closer to the surface, that blunt force trauma can rupture the spleen. And as you can imagine, it's going to be towards some problems, things like high amounts of blood loss because we have the stored blood in there. It's also a pretty splenic artery, brings in quite a lot of blood from the spleen and nerve circulation. So lymph nodes, spleen, and then the third accessory organ for the lymphatic system is the thymus gland. The thymus is also heavily involved in endocrine function, but really the endocrine function that we get from the thymus is really to assist in lymphatic function, because the thymus helps to produce hormones that are going to regulate the maturation of a class of lymphocytes called T lymphocytes. So our thymus actually sits right over the heart. It's been said to sit on there like a cap, or a cap over the heart. Don't confuse the thymus with the thyroid, which is nearby, but it's a different endocrine gland. It's a little bit higher, close to the Adam's apple. This is tucked into the heart. It is a primary endocrine organ, meaning the primary function of this gland is to act to generate hormones and release those hormones into the bloodstream. But those hormones are all targeted towards stimulating the maturation of the class of lymphocytes called the T lymphocytes. The T just simply stands for thymus. This is where these lymphocytes are actually being produced. These T lymphocytes, as they're called on to go to maturation, they're being called on to mature typically during some sort of new infection, an infection that you've never been exposed to before. And what happens is these T lymphocytes, they mature and they get programmed towards a specific invader. And when I say a specific invader, I'm talking about a specific rhinovirus, the virus that causes the cold, or a specific E. coli strain, which can cause gastrointestinal issues. So that process of basically saying, here's a foreign invader, you program yourself so the next time, the second time I'm exposed, I know that I need to attack that right away, and then you actually can prevent yourself from even really getting sick. That's called specific immunity. And these T lymphocytes are going to act in that specific immunity process. Is everybody good here? A fourth accessory organ for the lymphatic system are the tonsils, and a specialized form of tonsils called the adenoids. So we have the tonsils and the adenoids. And the tonsils and the adenoids are going to be found because of the lymphatic tissue that's found at the openings of the oral cavity and the opening of the nasal cavity. So comprised of lymphatic tissue, and it's lymphatic tissue that protects the throat, and lymphatic tissue that protects the nasal passageways. The throat and the nasal passageways. And really this lymphatic tissue acts as a filter. Whenever you breathe air, consume beverage, or consume food, you're passing that air, food, or beverage past a set of tonsils. And they are going to filter out microorganisms. filter out those microorganisms from beer, food, or beverage. You can see that there are several examples of tonsils located at the base of the oral cavity. We also have one here base where the nasal cavity begins to form into the pharynx. Those are called the adenoids. There's a couple other locations that you're going to find tonsils back of the mouth and even a little bit further down into the throat. How many of you have your tonsils or have had your tonsils removed? Okay, so some of you have had your tonsils removed. I'm going to pick on you real quick because I got a feeling that you're probably about 26. Am I close?
About 20-something.
20-something, but you're not like 19.
No.
And the reason I guess that is because you had your tonsils out and you don't do that anymore. Everyone else in here, they don't remove tonsils anymore. And the reason is because we actually recognize that they need to be there. And so rather than removing them, they treat them with antibiotics. They give a real heavy dose of antibiotics. I've also had my medicines removed, and I've always considered that. So they've removed my adenoids, they removed your tonsils, but now what they do is they treat them with a heavy dose of antibiotics to try to knock down the inflammation. The only reason people remove tonsils now is if they begin to reduce your capability to breathe, which is obviously problematic. So they do occasionally inflame. Standard used to be surgical removal. Now it's treated with antibiotics. The only reason that we may use a surgical procedure is to prevent breathing issues. Now that's not necessarily a hard and fast rule. It probably depends some on the doctor, but overall the trend has been to treat with antibiotics to see if you can get them to uninflame, because they actually will be beneficial to help filter the air, the food, and the beverage that you consume. Removal. My R got a little bit too long there, I guess. What I want to finish up with here with the lymphatic system is just to give you a brief kind of 300,000-foot view of how we defend against pathogens. We've identified the pathogens, we've identified the anatomy of the lymphatic system, that basic anatomy. So how do we actually put some physiology behind all of this, and how do we defend against pathogens? Remember, I started the whole lymphatic lecture. There are literally millions and millions and millions and billions and trillions of bacteria around here. It's on everything. Surface of the tables, on your skin, on stuff that you're drinking. Bacteria is everywhere. So how do we actually prevent all of these bacteria from causing us to constantly be in a state of disrepair? We have three lines of defense. It's obviously a military term. This is warfare. We're going to have three lines of defense. This would be called first line, second line, and the third line of defense. We'll start with the first line of defense. First line of defense is prevention of invasion. So use of physical and chemical barriers to basically prevent these microorganisms that are on you from getting deep inside of your cells and your tissues. So first line of defense is physical and chemical barriers. And we're just simply trying to deter entry here. one of the most obvious physical barriers that you have is your skin. And your skin is what covers most of your body. In fact, it's argued that's the largest of our organs is our skin. And the integrity of your skin is very important. As long as you don't have any open wounds or cuts or anything like that, you have a non-compromised physical barrier that prevents a lot of microorganisms from getting deeper into tissue. Not only do you have the skin, but all of the openings, whether it's the openings of the digestive system, openings of the urinary system, openings of the reproductive system, all of these openings are also going to be covered with additional physical and chemical barriers. So in one sense, you can sort of think of these coverings into the openings of the body being extensions of your skin, obviously. Tissue makeup is a little bit different, but these openings into your body, covered up by additional epithelial tissue that protects the underlying tissues, they also generate and produce solutions. And the solutions that are generated make survival of bacteria very difficult. So survival is not conducive. So if we were to measure the pH of these openings into the human body, we would find that they actually have a lower pH. They are more acidic. And an acidic environment is not, it's not real beneficial for bacteria. And so this, at the onset, reduces the probability of bacterial survival. But you also have some reflexes that, frankly, they kind of suck, but they're very important. One of those is the emanation reflex, which is to vomit. If you consume tainted food, you want to get that out. And so you go and you puke it out to get rid of as much of the material and bacteria that you just consumed to get them out, so that you can reduce the number of those invaders. So you have emanation reflexes, vomiting, or maybe it comes off the other end of this liquid as well. So those are very beneficial things, even though they're extremely disappointing. So that's going to be your first line of defense, these physical and chemical barriers. The second line of defense, if the physical and chemical barriers break down, they don't prevent invasion in the first place, we have a second line of defense. And the second line of defense is really a non-specific response. This is the shock and awe, so to speak, of the immune system. You're not targeting specific types of bacteria. You're just blowing everything up. If it's there, you're going to blow it up. So this is pretty indiscriminate. It's non-responsive. It's non-specific. And it's really a host of six different responses. And I'm going to detail each of these responses real quick as we close out this particular lecture. Response number one, we have cells, and we've already hit on a few of these. The macrophage is an example of a cell that consumes organisms. And it doesn't matter if you are this type of E. coli or that type of E. coli, the macrophage doesn't care. He wants something. And so that's what it's going to do. So we can consume the organism. Any cell that's not supposed to be there, we're going to start chopping that cell up. Response number two is a response called inflammation. Inflammation is just simply high blood flow. This is important because where you have an active invasion or an infection, Blood is what brings in the macrophages and brings in the lymphocytes and brings in other chemicals and other cell types. So if we can increase blood flow, inflame that area, we can bring in additional troops, so to speak, that are going to help out with this invasion process. The third response number three, we have a host of cells that go around, identify cells that aren't supposed to be in your body. Remember at the very beginning of the semester, we talked about this thing called the glycocalyx on the very outside of your cell. It's a fuzzy coat. And there's a bunch of molecules that are present that give your individual cell a fingerprint. And your immune system recognizes that fingerprint and can differentiate between one of your cells, because you have the right fingerprint, and another cell that doesn't have the right fingerprint, and will destroy indiscriminately those cells that aren't supposed to be there. Douse them with chemicals or break them apart, expose them to macrophages to destroy the cells that are not self-originating. Response number four of our second line of defense is this thing called the complement system. Now, the complement system is a series of proteins. There's actually 20 different complement proteins, and this is about as close to science fiction that you can get. These complement proteins, they're always present, but they're in an inactive form. So they circulate around your bloodstream in an inactive form. They are activated in the presence of microorganisms. And when they activate, they come together and they actually will begin to form a pore-like structure that can be popped into the membrane of the microorganism. So you begin to insert these pores into microorganisms, these complement proteins that form these pores. And what happens is you create this big hole in the cell, and you allow solutions to rush into the cell that causes the cell to blow up until it bursts and explodes. So these complement proteins are going to form that pore-like complex. So several proteins come together to form the complex, and it really is just an opening into the membrane or in the membrane, and then it causes swelling and eventually those cells burst, and when they burst, they're no longer going to be able to reproduce, create havoc for your tissues. So that's your fourth response. The fifth response is centered around a group of proteins called the interferons. Now, the interferons, they're actually kind of like a warning system. So when you begin to expose cells to foreign invaders and they begin to try to fight those off, those cells that are being invaded by the microorganisms, they begin to generate other molecules. And those other molecules begin to spill out into the surrounding. Those molecules, some of them are called the interferons. And really what the interferon does is it travels to other cells that are not actively being invaded by a microorganism, and they recept onto or they bind onto those cells, and they basically say, hey, we're getting killed over here. You probably should put up your defenses. And so then it turns those cells on to begin to prepare for an incoming invasion. So it's sort of like this early warning system that leads towards the nearby cells to prepare for an attack. So then they begin to produce other molecules and other proteins that are going to help out with this impinging attack that's certainly going to be coming their direction. All right, the sixth and final response Response number six is just simply to have a fever. Fevers are regulated by a group of proteins called pyrogens, pyromania. So the pyrogens will increase metabolism, which increases the accumulation of heat and brings up your body temperature. Now, a fever just simply is the response to that increase in heat being produced by your increased metabolism that results in an abnormally high body temperature. Now, if you've ever had a fever, you know that fevers really don't feel all that good. They're pretty uncomfortable. And what's happening is your own cells, and in particular the proteins in those cells, they begin to denature. Remember we talked about denaturing was basically taking the normal anatomy of the protein, the normal function of that protein, falls out of structure, and it begins to reduce its efficiency. So now your proteins aren't working as well as they should. But the bacteria, they're really susceptible to those higher elevated temperatures. And so now their proteins really begin to fall apart in the nature. They lose the function, and they no longer can sustain life. So this abnormally high body temperature, to a certain degree, it's actually beneficial to allow a temperature, an elevated temperature or a fever to persist if it's modest. So a modest fever or temperature is good because it's inhospitable for the pathogen. Now, obviously, if body temperature continues to increase, you're going to get to a point where your cells and your proteins begin to really malfunction, and that's not good. But you all can withstand a pretty modest increase in temperature. 100 degrees is not really, it's pretty uncomfortable, but it's not going to kill you, but it's going to really do a lot of damage to those foreign invaders. Now what happens when the second line of defense fails? We have one more defense mechanism. It's called the third line. That's supposed to be defense right there. The third line of defense. The third line of defense is actually called the immune system. So you remember at the very beginning of this lecture I said that the lymphatic system is what houses the immune system. Here's our immune system. Now, what exactly is our immune system? Our immune system becomes a very specific response to a specific pathogen. Okay? We actually call upon our third line of defense even before the first and the second line in a lot of cases are activated because of the specificity. If I've been exposed to a specific type of the virus that causes the cold, and I'm re-exposed to that, the immune system has been programmed to recognize that particular virus. And when it shows up again, it's kind of like the kid that you used to get beat up by in high school. You're like, I'm not going to, hey, here it comes. And you go the other way, right? I never got beat up in high school. So it's kind of like that situation where you see someone that you don't want to interact with. You already have this preconceived plan that I'm going to go the other way, or maybe you're just going to hit them. Whatever the case may be, when the rhinovirus that you've already interacted with, the virus that causes the cold, shows up, your third line of defense, the immune system says, you've been here before and you're bad, and it mobilizes cells that will wipe out that rhinovirus before it can cause any sort of pathology or symptomology. So really, the third line of defense is invoked when all other mechanisms fail, and you program cells against those specific invaders, and it becomes a very, very specific response. And then you have that adaptive response that follows up the third line of defense, your immune system's ability to target known pathogens. happened because you've had experience with them before. You go to attack them and to destroy them. So when all other mechanisms fail, or when we have subsequent exposure to a pathogen. All right, that's all the time I got.